He is Sir Fitzroy Maclean. And you were recently described as the supreme example of the soldier, politician, scholar, diplomat, raconteur, and man of many books, yes? And including your new book, which is Holy Russia. Now, you were listening to them, and you've told me already that you know the book, The Riddle of the Sun. Do you think that your life is like the kind of fiction of spies that we've just been listening to?
Well, I personally always kept as clear of anything to do with spying as I possibly could. I mean, sometimes I've come near to it. I've encountered spies, I've encountered spy masters, but I've never been a spy myself.
Now, that disappoints me, because I looked up your...
You probably don't believe it.
I don't believe you. And I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell you what clues that I found out about you in Who's Who, right? And I'm going to put them to you to see if you can prove to me you are not a spy. You worked behind the enemy lines with the Yugoslav partisans in 1943.
Right, so as a soldier.
Ah, as a soldier.
And as Winston Churchill's personal representative, and he wouldn't want to spy, would he, for his personal representative?
I see. Well, what a shame, because now I thought, you see, that you were working behind the enemy lines as an espionage.
No, I was watching the Germans. I mean, the Germans would have certainly have shot me if they could have caught me, but they fortunately didn't. But I was on the best of terms with President Tito, with Marshal Tito, as he then was.
Hmm. Oh, well, I thought that if the Germans had caught you, see, I was hoping you were going to say, no, they would not have captured me as a soldier, they'd have captured me as a spy. I'm wrong about that.
Well, I mean, I'd never asked them. But I hoped they would have regarded me as a soldier. I was in uniform the whole time.
Yes, right.
I was very careful about that.
Well, then, let me try and do one more question about it. 1942. You were in the SAS.
Certainly,
yeah. Yeah. Now, wasn't that something to do with espionage?
No, not at all. No, the SAS were not even intelligence gathering. Mm. The SAS were purely operational. We were out to blow things up, to shoot places up and so on, but not to spy. Mm-hmm. That was done by other people.
Well, then there was one other intriguing statement made about you, which also convinced me of something strange, right? And that is that you had travelled in parts of Russia forbidden to foreigners. So now how did you get to those parts?
I took a railway ticket.
Oh, I see. Oh, dear.
And the Russians didn't, in fact, stop me. Mm-hmm. Which, for reasons which they could probably explain better than I can. Mm-hmm. They may have been spying on me, they may have thought I was a spy, like you evidently do, and thought I might lead them to a nest of spies, but that didn't work out.
Well, I've always wanted to meet a spy.
No, I was just a traveller.
Right.
Bona fide traveller.
And, of course, you've been a traveller since, and you've written your book, Holy Russia, because, really, would it be exaggerated to say that you're in love with Russia?
Well, I'm fascinated by Russia, which may be the same thing, do you think?
Could
if you're
be.
Fascinated by somebody, you're well on the way to being in love with them.
That's right.
I always want to know what the next instalment is going to be. Mm. I've been watching Russia now. I'm a professional Kremlin watcher, and I've been watching Russia for 42 years, and I still never know what's coming next. Mm.
What Churchill said about Russia was that it was a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. That, in fact, I mean, outsiders wouldn't be able to understand it very easily.
I think he exaggerated a bit. I think a lot of it is mysterious, and I think it's difficult to know what is coming next, and they do their best to make it mysterious. Mm. A French observer 150 years ago said that one of the things the Russians were keenest on was to fooling the foreigner. Mm. And I think that is still true today, but I hope that they've stopped fooling me after 42 years.
Yes, right. When you first got to know Russia was when you were a very young diplomat, is that right?
That's it. I first went there in February 1947. Mm-hmm. 1937.
37, yes.
Yeah.
And how old were you?
I was 25.
Yes. Quite early to have been in the diplomatic service, yes?
No, I'd had 3 years in Paris before.
Already?
I'd learnt a lot there, too.
Yes. When you went to Russia, did you immediately think there was something about the country that you could understand?
Yes, I think so. I'd asked to be sent there. Mm. And in those days, nobody asked to be sent there, so it was the easiest thing in the world. Mm.
So why did you ask to be sent there?
Well, because I was fascinated. Partly because I'd had 3 years in Paris, and in those days there were a lot of fascinating white Russian emigres from before the revolution. Mm. And I was fascinated by the whole idea of Russia, but even more so by Central Asia, the Caucasus, all the remoter parts of the Soviet Union.
Mm. When you were in Russia, you parachuted. Your first parachute jump was in a funfair. That doesn't sound like Russia to me.
I'd forgotten about that altogether. But the first time I ever saw a parachute drop, a military parachute drop, was in Russia, and the first time I think that I ever, what Winston Churchill used to call jump out on a parachute, was also in Russia at a funfair. Mm. I didn't particularly enjoy it, but I thought there it was. I might as well try. I didn't realize that, two or three years later, I should be jumping out on a real parachute. Mm.
Why did you leave the diplomatic service and then join the army as a private?
Simply because I wanted to get into the war. It was a complicated business because it was, the diplomatic service was a reserved occupation, and if you were over a certain age, and I was over 25, you weren't allowed to resign. Mm. So I had to resort to the extraordinary, drastic expedient of standing for Parliament.
But saying you were going to stand for Parliament in order to get out of it?
That was it.
Really?
And in the end, I was forced, and that wasn't enough. I had to stand for Parliament. I did stand for Parliament. And Winston Churchill once said to somebody, "This is a young man who has made a public convenience of the Mother of Parliament." So I'm always very proud to have had that said about me.
Can we go back to Russia? If I were to go to Russia, I have not been, and I'm fascinated in a way, right? What would I find the most sort of welcoming thing about Russia, do you think? Because most of us think of it as rather cold and forbidding, I think.
I think the Russian people are very welcoming. Mm. And there's a lot about it that is cold, and a lot of Russian people are fairly cold and forbidding. Mm. The police, the customs authorities and so on are not all that friendly. But once you get to know an ordinary Russian citizen, they're as friendly as they can be. Mm. They're the most gregarious, friendly, hospitable people in the world.
And what do you think we would find the most alien thing about Russia?
Obviously it's a very tightly controlled society, and there are a whole lot of people who are shut up for their beliefs and that sort of thing. Mm. Mm. The whole thing is hag-ridden by restrictions of one kind or another. That is part of the system. Mm.
You won many medals in this list that I looked up of you, right? You have
one,
a lot
two,
of
yes.
medals. Yes, a lot of medals. Now, which country, because a lot of countries have given you a medal, which country were you proudest of receiving your medal from?
I think that would be invidious, but I'm very proud to have the Partisan Star from the Yugoslavs.
Yes. Yes,
that's something that I really value enormously.
And nobody who has earned a medal ever wants to say why did they? Which one did you most deserve? Do you think?
I've no idea. I never understood how medals got awarded.
You see,
I know how to. I mean, I've tried to get medals for people who served under my command, and I found that a good way of getting it was to say he advanced fearlessly across bullet-swept ground. That always seemed to impress people.
Thank you very much indeed for talking to me today.
Probably.